Our shared audio presents The Other Wife, written by Michael Robotham and read by Sean Barrett. Children begin by loving their parents. As they grow older, they judge them. Sometimes they forgive them. Oscar Wilde, The Picture of Dorian Gray. Day 1, Chapter 1. From the top of Primrose Hill, silhouetted against the arriving day, the spires and domes of London looked like the painted backdrop of a pinewood soundstage waiting for actors to take their places and an unseen director to yell, "Action!" I love this city. Built upon the ruins of the past, every square foot of it has been used, reused, flattened, bombed, dismantled, rebuilt and flattened again, until the layers of history are like sediments of rock that one day will be picked over by future archaeologists and treasure hunters. I am no different, a broken man built upon the wreckage of my past. It has been 13 years since I was diagnosed with Parkinson's. It began with an unconscious, random flicker of my fingers on my left hand, a ghost movement that looked like a twitch, but read like a guilty verdict. Unknown to me, working in secret, my body had begun a long, drawn-out separation from my mind. A divorce where nobody gets to keep the record collection or fights over who gets the dog. That small rolling of the thumb and forefinger has now spread silently through my limbs until they no longer do my bidding without the assistance of drugs. When I'm medicated properly, I can appear to be almost symptom-free, a little stooped and more deliberate in my movements, but normal in most respects. At other times, Mr. Parkinson is a cruel puppeteer, tugging at invisible strings, making me dance to music that only he can hear. There is no cure, not yet, but I live in hope that science will win the race. In the meantime, daily exercise is recommended. That's why I'm standing here, with all of London's mangled and magnificent history on display. My eyes sweep from east to west and settle on the curved rooftops and netting of London Zoo. Julianne and I bought our first house a few streets from here. We would lie in bed on warm nights when the curtains swayed from open windows, listening to the calls of lions and hyenas and animals we couldn't name. It is 16 months since she died. A surgical complication, they said. A blood clot that travelled from her groin to her heart and lodged in her left ventricle. She lived for a week on life support, lying on white sheets, looking tranquil and beautiful, but not at home, according to the neurologist. We turned off the machines, and she slipped away like an empty rowing boat cut loose in the current. The seasons since then have been like stages of grieving. Summer passed in denial and isolation. Autumn brought anger, winter blame, and by spring my depression had driven me to seek help. I endure for the sake of my daughters, Charlie and Emma, because they deserve more than tragedy as their template, and so much of Julianne lives within them. From the parting of their hair, to the inflection in their voices, and the way they walk, frown, and laugh. We moved back to London a year ago after selling the cottage in Somerset. I used the money from the sale and a bank loan to buy a top-floor flat in a mansion block called Wellington Court in Belsize Park, not far from Primrose Hill. Airy and bright, with high ceilings and a large bay window in the sitting room, it has 3 bedrooms and a small roof terrace accessible from the kitchen window, where Emma and I sometimes watch the sun setting over London, while sitting on deck chairs like passengers on an ocean liner. Emma is 12. I left her sleeping at the flat with an alarm set for school. No longer my little girl. She's on the cusp of womanhood, with green-gray eyes, curly hair, and skin so pale it looks almost powdered, like a kabuki dancer. In January, she started at Northbridge House, an independent day school in North London, with the sort of fees to make my eyes water. The scholarship came as a bonus and a surprise. My eldest, Charlie, is in her second year at Oxford, studying behavioural psychology. Parents are normally proud when children follow in their footsteps, but I take no pleasure in Charlie wanting to be a forensic psychologist. because I know where her fascination lies and how it started. She wants to understand why some people commit terrible acts and fantasize about even worse crimes, the psychopaths and sociopaths who haunt her nightmares. Continuing down the hill, I cross the canal into Regent's Park. A young woman jogs past me, her buttocks hugged by lycra and her ponytail bobbing on her back. I contemplate catching up with her. We could run together, connect. I'm dreaming. She's gone. I have an appointment this morning with Dr. Victoria Napastik at a cafe not far from her office in Harley Street. Victoria is a good-looking woman. 40-something, slim, striking. I slept with her once when Julianne and I were separated. Victoria broke it off. When I asked her why, she said, "You're still in love with your wife." I asked her if that mattered. "It does to me," she replied. She's waiting for me at a cafe in Portland Place. Dressed in an A-line skirt and matching jacket, with a simple white blouse open at the neck, she smiles and her dimples leave an impression on her cheeks. "Professor O'Loughlin." "Dr. Napastik, you're sweaty. See what you do to me." We banter, flirt a little. A waitress has come to take our order. Tea, coffee, toast, jam. Everybody told me that I should talk to someone after Julianne's death. I know the benefits of grief counseling, yet I fought against the idea until Victoria called me a fucking idiot and a typical man who shuts down and pretends the problem doesn't exist. "You look good," she says. "I am." My first lie. "Have you been sleeping?" "Yes." Another one. "And the dreams?" "One or two. Always the same?" I nod. This is part of our routine, therapy without being therapy. She will quiz me, I will answer, and neither of us will feel under any obligation to reveal confidences or offer advice. Victoria wants me to verbalize my worst fears, but I don't have to put them into words because I live them every day. I don't have to imagine being alone, or having an illness, or suddenly bursting into tears over a broken cup or a dropped egg. "How is Emma?" she asks. "Good. Better. We spent yesterday painting her room and putting stencils on the walls." "Did she mention Julianne?" "No." "What about the photographs?" "She won't look at them." Emma hasn't cried or rebelled or asked questions about her mother's death. She won't visit Julianne's grave, or look at photographs of her, or reminisce about the past. This isn't about denial or pretending nothing has changed. Emma knows that Julianne isn't coming back, but refuses to labor the point or have it define our existence. Some nights I've found her hiding in her wardrobe, curled in a ball. "What's wrong?" "I can't sleep." "That's okay. Just rest your eyes." "What if I never sleep again?" "You will." "What if I'm the only one awake? The whole world will be sleeping and I'll be on my own in the dark, with nobody to help me."
"I'll be here."
"Promise you won't fall asleep until I do."
"I promise."
Emma worries about me because I am the last parent standing. When we cross the street, she insists on holding my hand, not to protect herself, but to protect me. She makes sure that I eat well and exercise and take my medication. I wake sometimes to find her leaning over my bed with her hand on my chest. She counts the number of breaths. 3 sets of 9. 27. Usually that's enough to reassure her. Our coffees have arrived. Victoria tears open a sachet of sugar and shakes the contents into the foam.
"Did you ask Emma if she'd talk to me?"
She's not sold on the idea.
"I understand."
"I don't want to push her."
"You shouldn't. Let her make the decision when she's ready."
I've given the same advice to countless grieving parents when they've visited my consulting rooms, but when it comes to my own flesh and blood, I begin to question my 30 years of clinical experience as a psychologist. My mobile phone is vibrating on the table.
I don't recognize the number.
Is that Professor O'Loughlin? Asked the female voice.
Yes.
This is the registrar at St. Mary's Hospital in Paddington. Your father, William O'Loughlin, has been admitted with serious head injuries.
Head injuries?
He underwent surgery 6 hours ago.
Surgery?
To relieve pressure on his brain. He was bleeding internally. Right now he's in a medically induced coma.
Coma?
Why am I repeating everything she says?
The cafe has a shelf of bonsai plants, miniature trees with gnarled trunks and moss-covered branches. I find myself staring at the shrunken forest, no longer listening to what the registrar is saying. And my knees are shaking.
Are you there, Professor?
Yes, sorry. What was my father doing in London? What difference does it make?
I don't have that information, replies the registrar.
Of course she doesn't, it's a stupid question.
Does my mother know? She's with him now.
Can I talk to her?
We don't allow mobile phones in the ICU.
I see. Right, tell her I'm coming.
I end the call and stare at the blank screen.
I should call my sisters. No, Mum will have done that. I should catch a cab. Emma is at home. I'm supposed to walk her to school, and then I have patients to see. I can cancel my appointments.
Victoria searches for her wallet.
You go. Call me later.
Within moments, I'm on the pavement looking for a cab. Three of them pass, occupied. I start jogging, desperately trying to lift my feet and swing my arms in sequence. Traffic is backed up along Euston Road. I cut across Regent's Park and up Primrose Hill. My lungs hurt and lactic acid is building up in my legs. Having climbed the stairs at Wellington Court, I'm ready to collapse.
Did you run all the way?
Asks Emma, who is sitting at the kitchen bench in her school uniform, a striped dress, red cardigan, black tights and buckled shoes.
Grandad, in hospital. I have to go.
What happened?
Some sort of accident. I need a shower.
Is he going to be okay?
He's in good hands.
Emma follows me down the hallway.
Bad things happen at hospitals.
What do you mean?
People die.
Her lips are pulled down at the corners and her tea-coloured eyes are shining.
Not always. Most of them get better,
I say, knowing that my words sound hollow to someone who has lost her mother.
I don't want you to go, she says.
Nothing is going to happen to me.
At least let me come. You have school. Who's going to take me?
I'll talk to the boys.
The boys are men, Duncan and Arturo, a gay couple who live on the floor below. One works in advertising and the other runs an art gallery in Islington. Having showered and changed, I knock on their door. Duncan answers. He's wearing a short gown, just long enough to brush the top of his thighs.
Joseph!
He says excitedly, kissing both my cheeks. I bend in the middle to avoid groin-to-groin contact.
My dad is in hospital. Can one of you take Emma to school?
Duncan relays the message over his shoulder, and Arturo replies, yelling from the kitchen.
I can take her on the back of my bike.
I want to say no. Duncan does it for me.
You're not taking her on the bike. You ride like a maniac. I did a safe riding course with Evil Knievel.
I've triggered a domestic dispute. Duncan waves me away.
You go. I'll walk her. I hope your father is all right.
Minutes later, I'm in a cab, stuck in traffic on Edgware Road, listening to the talkback callers complaining about Brexit, fake news, immigrants and low wages. I've grown tired of politics and current affairs. I don't want to be informed by journalists or governed by politicians of any persuasion. Democracy has failed. Let's try a benign dictatorship.
My father is in a coma. He's turned 80 this year and I don't remember him ever being in hospital.
Not as a patient. I long ago labelled him God's personal physician-in-waiting because of his indefatigable energy and unrivalled self-belief. For more than 50 years he was a medical giant. A professor of surgery and public health, advisor to governments, founder of the International Trauma Research Unit, lecturer, author, commentator, and philanthropist. Our family's charitable trust, the O'Loughlin Foundation, gives millions of pounds in research grants each year. I saw Dad 2 weeks ago. We had lunch at his club in Mayfair, a pleasant enough 2 hours in a tweedy, past-the-port sort of way. I don't remember what we spoke about. Nothing meaningful. He looked well, happy. He spends most of his time at the farmhouse in Wales, but comes to London quite regularly for meetings and lectures. The cab arrives at St. Mary's, and I hurry past a cluster of nurses and orderlies smoking cigarettes on the pavement. The major trauma ward is on the 9th floor. Waiting for the lift to arrive, I catch that hospital smell of antiseptic, floor polish, and bodily fluids. Memories bubble up and scald my throat. Swallowing hard, I force them down, tasting the vomit. I press a buzzer outside the ICU. A nursing sister answers, the heavy door sucking inwards like she's opening an airlock. "My father is here, William O'Loughlin. My mother is with him." Her smile is encouraging. I wonder how long she's practiced it. "Please wash your hands," she says, showing me to a sink with antibacterial soap and a paper towel dispenser. I follow her through a long, dimly lit ward, past rows of beds partitioned by machines and curtains. Each pool of light contains someone who is close to death, plugged in, taped up, filled and drained, hydrated and evacuated, medicated and sedated. "He's the last cubicle," says the nurse. "Please don't try to wake him." I approach tentatively, catching my first glimpse of a broken man lying on a bed, imprisoned by tubing and cables. His head is heavily bandaged. An oxygen mask covers his mouth. IV bags hang above his head. Needles have been driven into his veins. Sensors are monitoring his vital signs. I want to turn back and say, "That's not my father. There's been a mistake." But I know it's him. A woman is sitting beside the bed, partially in shadow. She looks up as though startled, her eyes red-rimmed and bruised from lack of sleep. Letting go of Dad's hand, she gets to her feet.
"It's Joseph, isn't it?"
I nod. "I didn't want us to meet like this." "I don't understand. Where's my mother?"
"She's not here."
"But I was told..."
"I asked the hospital to call you."
"I'm sorry, but who are you?"
"I'm his other wife."
Chapter 2. How long do I stand there, unable to speak? I laugh uncomfortably, which is supposed to be her cue to say that she's joking. She doesn't take it. I look feeble and embarrassed, growing angry at her silence. What sort of cruel joke is this? Where are the hidden cameras? When will someone jump out and yell, "April Fool"? Only it's November, not April, and I don't think I'm a fool. The man in bandages is my father. The woman next to him is not my mother.
"I'm Olivia Blackmore," she says, offering her hand.
I look at her outstretched fingers as though she's pointing a gun.
"I think you've made a mistake," I say. "How did you get my number?" "William told me that if something like this happened, I was to call you first."
"Something like what?" "An accident or an emergency." In her 40s, with dark hair and the remnants of makeup, she has a slight accent. East European, perhaps, which has faded over time. She's wearing high-heeled shoes, dark tights, and a loosely belted trench coat.
"I was told my mother was here." The nurse misunderstood me.
I'm searching for words in vain.
"Is my mother coming?"
"No." I start again.
"What happened to him?"
"I found him at the bottom of the stairs."
"What stairs?"
"At the house."
"Whose house?"
"Ours."
"Who are you?"
"I'm his wife."
"He's already married?"
"His other wife."
"You're his mistress?"
"No." It's a fatuous conversation. I want to stop myself. Why am I deigning to talk to her? Clearly she's crazy.
How did she get past security?
I try again. He can only have one wife. Are you saying he's a bigamist?
Olivia shakes her head. I'm sorry, Joseph. I'm not making myself very clear. I know this comes as a shock. Your father, William, made a commitment to me. We married in Bali. It was a Buddhist ceremony.
He's never been to Bali.
You're mistaken.
He isn't a Buddhist.
No, she replies, but I am.
My body chooses this moment to freeze. It does that occasionally. Locks up or ceases completely, as though playing a game of musical statues and someone has stopped the music.
Do you need your medication? How does she know about that? I can get you some water.
She touches my forearm.
No,
I snap, brushing her hand away. Olivia steps back as though suddenly frightened of me. She resumes her seat, reaching across the sheet to hold Dad's hand.
I don't want you touching him. Excuse me?
Get your hands off him, or I'll call the police.
Go ahead.
It occurs to me that nobody has contacted my mother. I take out my phone.
You can't use that in here, says Olivia, pointing to a sign. You'll have to go outside.
I step closer to the bed, whispering angrily.
I don't know who you are or why you're here, but my father and my mother have been married for 60 years. He doesn't have other wives. Just me, she says softly.
I want you to leave, I say, furious with her.
Please don't raise your voice.
I'll do as I damn well please. An ICU nurse arrives, drawn by our argument. Moon-faced and pretty, with dreadlocked hair, she tells us both to be quiet.
This woman is not my mother, I tell her. She's tricked her way in.
The nurse looks at Olivia suspiciously. Is that true?
No, I'm his wife. I've never seen her before, I say. I want her out of here.
Olivia pleads.
I know you're upset, Joseph, but don't do this. Go and call your mother. I'll sit with William.
Her belted coat has fallen open. Underneath, she's wearing a pale green cocktail dress, stained by something darker. Is that blood? She closes the coat.
I found him. He was lying at the bottom of the stairs.
Where?
I told you, at the house in Chiswick. It's where we live.
I shake my head.
No, no, no. I'm telling you the truth.
You're delusional. The nurse has heard enough. I want you both to leave.
Please, we'll be quiet, says Olivia.
I'm calling security, says the nurse. They can sort this out.
Somebody has to stay, says Olivia, looking at Dad.
No, both of you get out. She's not going to change her mind. Olivia collects her handbag from beneath the chair. I wait for her to leave first in case she tries something. I don't know what I expect. She could sabotage the machines or smother Dad with a pillow. The ICU doors close behind us. Olivia takes a tissue from her coat pocket and blows her nose.
I have heard so many good things about you, Joseph, but I didn't think you'd be so cruel.
She pauses, making sure I've heard, before moving away and taking a seat further along the corridor. She searches her handbag and finds another tissue. I call my mother's number. The phone rings. I picture her padding down the hallway at the farmhouse in Wales, picking up the receiver, using her posh-sounding phone voice. But there's no answer. She has a mobile phone. I try the number. She answers, shouting to be heard above the background noise.
Joseph?
Where are you?
I'm on the train.
Are you coming to London?
No. Why?
Dad is in hospital, intensive care. I hear her sudden inhalation. He's in the ICU. They operated last night. I'm here now. I thought they might have called you.
No.
Her voice is trembling. He has head injuries. I don't know all the details. You should be here.
Yes, of course. I'll...
What was Dad doing in London? I ask.
He had a board meeting. He left yesterday. What happened?
I think he fell down the stairs.
Did the girls know?
She's talking about my sisters, Lucy, Patricia, and Rebecca. I'm going to call them.
Please don't leave your father alone, she says. Stay with him.
I will. After ending the call, I glance up and see two police officers emerge from the lifts, one in uniform and the other in plain clothes. The detective is older and heavier, with wire-rimmed glasses and Nordic features. He talks to a nurse who points them along the corridor in my direction. I wait for them, but they're not looking for me. They stop at Olivia, who looks up from her phone. I can't hear the conversation, but I see her grow agitated. She's been busted, exposed as a liar. Good. In the same instant, I see hurt rather than fear in her eyes. They're preparing to leave. Olivia looks at her feet, as though she might have dropped something.
Where are you taking her?
I ask, having moved closer. The detective turns to face me, setting his legs apart.
What's your name, sir?
Joseph O'Loughlin. Are you related to William O'Loughlin?
He's my father. Can I see some identification?
I show him my driver's license. He motions to Olivia Blackmore.
Do you know this woman?
No.
Have you ever seen her before?
Never.
Why?
The detective ignores the question and turns away, walking towards the lift. I follow.
What happened to him? Was it an accident?
Neither officer breaks stride. They're at the lift. I stop the doors from closing.
Did she do this?
Please step back, says the detective.
Where are you taking her?
Chiswick Police Station. The doors are closing. Olivia raises her eyes to mine.
If he wakes up, tell him. Tell him I love him.
Chapter 3. My eldest sister, Lucy, lives in Henley, west of London, with her husband Eric, an air traffic controller, and their three children, whose names I can never remember because they all end in the same E sound. I punch out her number and listen to it ringing. Lucy answers. My left arm trembles. She's in the car, the school run.
Can you talk? I'm on the hands-free. What's wrong? Dad is in hospital. He's had some sort of accident. They operated last night to relieve pressure on his brain.
Her voice changes, rising higher.
Was he driving? A fall, I think. He's at St. Mary's in Paddington. Have you talked to him? He's in a coma. Christ! Where's Mummy? She's catching a train. What about Patricia and Rebecca? I called you first.
Lucy is the natural leader among my siblings, the competent, organized figure who arranges family gatherings, remembers birthdays, and coordinates our secret Santa present buying each Christmas. Patricia, my middle sister, lives in Cardiff with her husband Simon, a criminal barrister. Rebecca, the youngest girl, is a high achiever who works for the World Bank in Geneva. I'm the baby of the family, the long-awaited boy, although not the little prince. I abdicated that position when I chose to become a psychologist rather than a surgeon, ending a medical dynasty that dated back more than a century.
I'll call Patricia, says Lucy, taking charge. Rebecca is in South Sudan. You might reach her on her mobile. I'll be there as soon as I can.
After Lucy hangs up, I call Rebecca's mobile and leave a message, giving her the briefest of details, telling her not to worry and to call me. What should I do next? There must be other friends or family I can contact, but I don't want to share the news, not yet. Functioning on a kind of autopilot, I stare out the window at a skyline dotted with cranes and half-built office towers. Pigeons wheel across a pale blue sky that is marked by the chalk-like smudges of jets traveling in the troposphere. A day like this should be darker and bleak. It should mirror the news or my mood. Returning to the ICU, I sit beside Dad and take his hand, something I haven't done since I was a child. Did I do it as a child? I must have done. I study his face. His hair, so white and thick, was dyed until his mid-50s, but turned white overnight when he threw away the bottle and aged as gracefully as he lived. A stranger might believe the wrinkles around his eyes were laughter lines, but the runnels are deepest where his skin has folded most often, perfectly illustrating his complaining nature and general dissatisfaction with people, particularly his children, most notably me. This feels strange, being so intimate. I don't think in my entire life I have spent 10 minutes alone with Dad when he didn't demean, belittle, or insult me.
Maybe that's an exaggeration, but his opinions were mostly disapproving or judgmental. Children were to be seen and not heard, never mollycoddled or overpraised. There is no lightness about my father, no play or mischief. Growing up, I don't remember him singing ditties or doing silly dances or acting the goat. He didn't chase us around the garden or play hide-and-seek or put on funny voices. He didn't get us dressed or make us breakfast or drop us at school or drive us to sport or listen to us practice piano or help with our homework. When we fell over and hurt ourselves, none of us ran to Dad or cried his name or crawled onto his lap. I'm not saying he neglected us. Others fulfilled these tasks, my mother, nannies, au pairs or housekeepers. Dad was needed elsewhere, required by the wounded or broken or diseased. He saved lives. He pioneered surgical techniques. He battled infections that ate children and illnesses that tore families apart. Some women are referred to as being natural mothers, and men as being natural fathers. I don't know what that means. My father is simply my father. Stiff, self-conscious, opinionated, cantankerous, demanding, absent. Even when home, he would spend long hours in his study. If we were playing in the garden, we knew to keep the noise down or risk having him open the window and bellow for us to be quiet. One time, Rebecca peed her pants at the sound of his voice, although she was notorious for peeing her pants when she got too excited. When I was 8 or 9, I complained of being hungry, and Dad denied me food all day so I could experience deprivation and appreciate the most basic of elements. Another time, when I forgot to keep the wood-fired aga alight, he made everyone eat a cold supper, insisting my sisters share my punishment. Where was my mother in all this? In the middle, keeping the peace. She hugged, kissed, bathed, bandaged, and mended. She told us every day that Dad loved us and made us say prayers for him. As a boy, I realized very quickly that Dad wasn't like other fathers. At social gatherings, he didn't stand around the barbecue, drinking beer and turning sausages, talking cricket or rugby. He stood on the fringes, a glass of fizzy water in his hand, wearing black brogues and grey flannel trousers, even in the height of summer. Socially awkward, he was always on the margins, not so much a square peg in a round hole as a square peg in a world full of round holes. On a father and son camping trip, I was astonished when he agreed to come. We were sitting around a campfire when one of the other fathers said that we only use 10% of our brains. "That's incorrect," Dad replied. "A lot of people make that mistake. They think that geniuses like Albert Einstein and Stephen Hawking use more of their brain than the rest of us. It's an idea propagated by self-improvement hucksters and people who join Mensa, but it's not true. Doctors have imaged the brain tens of thousands of times with MRI and PET scans. There are no inactive areas." "And what makes you such an expert?" said the other father, his voice hardening. "I'm not an expert. I'm a doctor." "And that makes you God's gift?" "I don't believe in God." People laughed around the campfire. The other father said Dad was a smart ass. "Clearly I've upset you," he replied. "I apologize. There are many medical myths. People believe that sweating gets rid of toxins, or that reading in poor light damages eyesight, or we shouldn't go swimming after eating, or shaving hair makes it grow back thicker and darker. It's not true. Cold weather doesn't give us more colds. Coffee doesn't sober us up. Your heart doesn't stop when you sneeze. And one arsehole isn't any smarter than another, though proctology isn't really my field." I thought Dad was going to get punched, but he has one brilliantly disarming feature. A laugh that opens his mouth wide, showing all his teeth, and releasing a joyous rumble that warms the heart. When he laughs, others follow. Problem solved. In the semi-darkness of the ICU, I noticed the same nurse sitting on a high stool behind the machines. Was I talking out loud? She nods and steps into the light, introducing herself as Henrietta. Her Jamaican accent makes the name sound musical. "Is that really William O'Loughlin?" she asks. "Yes. The whole hospital is talking about him."
What are they saying? He's a famous doctor.
Once, yes. Henrietta says she is due to change his dressings. I offer to help. She hands me a polished steel tray containing scissors, cotton gauze, and compression bandages. Unwrapping the progressively bloody layers, I see the stapled stitches where my father's shattered skull has been patched together. I can see the dome of his half-shaved head, which is no longer symmetrical, but concave on the right, like the shell of a hard-boiled egg that has been cracked with a spoon. The sheet has been pushed down to my father's pale chest, and I notice deep bruises on his ribcage and sides. Clearly they're not from any recent fall or attempts at resuscitation. Bruises change color over time. Red, blue, and purple are the early colors. Greens appear after 4 or 5 days, and yellow comes after a week. I take out my phone and turn on the camera. "You're not supposed to take pictures," says Henrietta. "These weren't caused by falling downstairs," I say, holding my fist over the darkest of the bruises. "See the shape? This line of discoloration came from knuckles. Someone gave him a beating." Henrietta lets me finish. She rewraps Dad's skull, cradling his head gently.
"Professor O'Loughlin," says another voice.
I turn to find a nursing sister.
"The neurosurgeon has asked to speak to you."
Taking a final look at Dad, I follow her through the ICU to a patient lounge opposite the main doors. The pastel-painted room has sofas, vending machines, and a rack of magazines. The surgeon is counting coins in his hand. He reaches into the change bin the way a child might.
"You don't have a spare pound, do you?"
he asks. I find one in my jacket.
"Excellent. Low blood sugar. I get the shakes if I skip meals."
He feeds coins into the machine and presses a button. A chocolate bar drops into the tray with a thunk.
"I'm Pete Hanover,"
he says, offering his hand. Warm and chipper, he's about my age, dressed in chinos and an open-necked shirt that clings to his pot belly. He takes a bite of the chocolate bar, chewing and talking.
"Your father lectured at my university when I was in pre-med. A remarkable man."
The word remarkable can have so many different meanings. "Is he going to live?" I ask. The bluntness of the question dispenses with the need for small talk.
"Let's start at the beginning,"
says Hanover, pointing me to a sofa. He sits opposite, showing his ankles when he crosses his legs.
"Your father arrived at the hospital just after midnight, suffering from catastrophic head injuries. Paramedics had intubated him at the scene and had to resuscitate him twice in transit. He was unconscious and bleeding from both ears. His right pupil was enlarged and unresponsive."
The word unresponsive bounces around inside my head, and I recall how the specialist had talked about Julianne when she was on life support. An immediate CT scan revealed traumatic brain injuries and an acute subdural hematoma. Bleeding, yes. I operated immediately to reduce the pressure in his cranium and managed to remove several clots in his anterior lobe. William is now in a medically induced coma. This is important in case the ruptured blood vessels are unable to deliver the usual amounts of oxygen to his brain. He's also receiving diuretics to reduce the fluid in his body and anti-seizure drugs. Once the swelling goes down, we'll scan him again. This could be 5 or 6 days from now. Then we'll slowly lower the dosage of the drugs and bring him back. Crumpling the chocolate wrapper, Hanover tosses it overhead at a nearby bin. Missing. "Don't worry. I'm a better surgeon than basketballer."
"Will he recover?"
"The pressure on his brain was enormous and is likely to have caused multiple smaller hemorrhages. We won't know the extent of the damage for a while yet. I assume you've spoken to the police about the assault."
"What assault?"
He frowns. "Your father's head injuries were caused by blunt force trauma. I was told he fell down the stairs."
"That might be the case, but he was also struck from behind, repeatedly. The blows were so violent that pieces of his skull were driven into his brain."
My mind rushes to judgment. The woman, Olivia Blackmore. She was covered in his blood. That's why the police are questioning her. She attacked him and made up some story of him falling down the stairs.
Hanover's mobile begins chirping. He takes the call.
I'm afraid I have to go, he says. Should William require more surgery, I'll talk to you again. In the meantime, a neurologist will manage his care. Thank you, I say, shaking his hand. I squeeze too hard and he flinches. Occupational hazard, he explains. I have to look after these. He holds up his childlike palms, showing me his delicate fingers and slender wrists. Fit for purpose. Who wants a brain surgeon with big hands? After he's gone, I find the men's room. Locking myself in a cubicle, I close the seat and sit down. I want to weep, but have no idea who the tears would be for. My father, my mother, my sisters, or me? Washing my face in the sink, I glance at my dripping reflection, trying to see what others see. I have my mother's eyes, lips, and nose. What is there of my father? Our names blur into each other. He is William Joseph and I am Joseph William, but that's where the similarities end. A door opens behind me. A young boy of 11 or 12 enters the men's room, wheeling a drip on an upright stand and wearing a surgical cap. I smile at the boy, who looks away nervously. He's been told not to talk to strange men or acknowledge them, which is sensible but also sad. I wonder what's wrong with him. Is he sicker than my father? Is his life worth more? Does youth trump brilliance? I feel guilty for having such thoughts. Back in the ICU, I take a seat beside Dad, unable to bring myself to hold his hand again. I lost a wife a year ago. I cannot lose anyone else. I have paid my dues. I've given. It's someone else's turn. In my imagination, I see my dad's eyes open. All this fuss, he says. I must be dying. You're going to be fine, I reply. Don't kid me, Joseph. I'm a doctor. Chapter 4. Lucy arrives shortly before 11, out of breath and peeling off layers in the overheated hospital. She hugs me as though I'd been away for years. When did she start to smell like my mother?
How is he?
Not good.
Dying?
Fighting. I tell her the details, leaving out the part about blunt force trauma and the mysterious woman I found sitting by his bed. I tell myself I'm protecting her, but I don't know exactly why. If Olivia Blackmore attacked our father, she won't remain a secret for long. I warn Lucy about what to expect, but she's still shocked by the sight of Dad. The tubes from his mouth and nose, the drips and cables. Someone has written on the white bandage around his head with a black marker pen, "No bone flap."
Silly old duffer. What have you done, making us worry like this?
Asks Lucy, making it sound like Dad has grazed his knee. She kisses his cheek, strokes his hand. Her questions begin.
Where was he found? Who called the ambulance? How did you find out?
Each one leads to another.
Why was he in Chiswick? What friend? Who is she?
I can't keep fobbing her off and obfuscating. Olivia Blackmore. She says that she's married to Dad. Lucy's eyes widen and she grabs my arm, pulling me away from the bed.
Who is this woman? And why would she say such a thing?
I don't know. Lucy makes a coughing sound.
Did you call the police?
I take a deep breath and tell her all that I know, glimpsing the attack in my mind, the paramedics, the sirens and flashing lights, hospital doors crashing open, the white coats and theater lights.
You say her dress was covered in blood?
Yes.
Did she attack him?
She denies it.
But the police have arrested her.
They're talking to her. Lucy looks nonplussed and strangely unsure of herself.
I don't think we should say anything to Mummy or Patricia. Not until we know more.
Agreed. My mother arrives mid-afternoon. As always, she looks the epitome of the country doctor's wife, dressed in her travelling clothes, a tweed skirt, white blouse and pearls. Her grey perm is cut short, framing a wedge-shaped face. We hug. She kisses my cheek, calls me Joseph, darling.
What happened?
Have you spoken to him?
He's in a coma.
Where are the doctors? What are they doing? Do they know who he is?
They know. She looks around, thinking she's lost her handbag, which is still looped over her shoulder. Turning full circle, she finds the bag and chides herself for being so foolish. I take her into the ICU. Sighting my father, she lets out a soft cry and bustles to his bedside, kissing his forehead and straightening his fringe, as though expecting a photographer to arrive at any moment. I feel embarrassed. My parents rarely display affection. I don't think I've ever witnessed more than a peck on a cheek or a squeeze of the hand.
Are you making a nuisance of yourself?
She asks, fixing the top button of his pajamas.
It's the pretty nurses, isn't it? You want to be looked after.
Lucy sniffles. I hand her a packet of tissues. Her eyes say, I told you she'd be like this. My mother is still talking, barely pausing for breath, explaining that she's brought his slippers and a toothbrush.
And don't worry, Vula Pierce is looking after the dogs.
She takes a seat, holds his hand. It's the same chair that Olivia Blackmore occupied a few hours ago.
Where is Patricia? She asks.
She's coming, I reply.
And Rebecca?
I left her a message. Henrietta comes down off her stool. Only two visitors are allowed per patient. One of us will have to leave. I volunteer. There are things I need to do. Talking to the police is one. My mother hugs me goodbye, and instantly the years drop away. I'm a child again, lost in the warmth of her bosom and the folds of her skirt. Mum seems to feel it too, touching my cheek with her fingers.
Thank you, Joseph. You're a good boy.
Chapter 5. Chiswick Police Station is a red brick and concrete building with blue painted doors, twin flagpoles and a bulletin board appealing for eyewitnesses and advertising crime prevention programs. The station sergeant closes a copy of the Daily Mail and gets tiredly to his feet as though irritated by another interruption. His white shirt has a pen stain on the breast pocket which matches the color of his epaulettes. And you have information about this alleged assault? He says, taking down my name. I'm the victim's son. I was hoping to speak to the detective in charge. He makes a call. I wait. The station foyer has a dozen plastic chairs. Only one of them is taken by a bald man dressed in a turtleneck sweater that makes his head look like an egg in an egg cup. He nods to me. We don't make eye contact again. Instead, I focus my thoughts on Olivia Blackmore, trying to estimate her age. Mid-40s, well-groomed, expensively dressed. Her cocktail dress clung to her curves, showing off her figure. I can imagine her turning heads, but not my father's. God's personal physician in waiting is not some aging Lothario. He doesn't chase skirt or chat up women. He's conservative, predictable, honorable, upright. Beige. A lot of men reach midlife and lament the passing of their youth and unfulfilled dreams. Some succumb to sharp new clothes, sports cars, adventure holidays, and the lure of younger women. That's not William O'Loughlin. I'm not exaggerating when I say that my father has always seemed to be asexual or completely uninterested in women unless they're presenting some surgical challenge anesthetized on his operating table. A junior detective steps from the lift and motions me to follow. I'm taken upstairs to an incident room where rumpled men are sitting at rumpled desks, with coats hanging off the back of their chairs and ties lowered to half-mast. Detective Inspector Stuart McDermid is 40-plus, prematurely grey, with a weathered face that hangs on his skull like a partially deflated balloon. His right hand is swollen and twisted in on itself. Arthritis, early onset. Painful. Holding a phone to his ear, he motions to a chair. I sit down. The detective doesn't seem to be talking to anyone. Either he's listening to someone, or using the moment to study me. I do the same, glancing around the office. A hand-signed Glasgow Rangers shirt is framed on the wall, beside team photographs of them crowned as Scottish champions, holding the trophy aloft as ticker tape rains down on their heads. Elsewhere, there's a small bronze statue of a racehorse in full flight, with the jockey out of the saddle, whip hand raised. McDermott puts down the phone and cocks an eyebrow. You got my message, Professor O'Loughlin?
What message?
I asked you to come.
I came of my own accord.
He frowns and lets it pass. Well, you're here now. Opening his laptop, he hits the keyboard with one finger as though it's operated by brute force. Do you know a woman called Olivia Blackmore?
I met her this morning.
She claims to be married to your father.
She's lying.
They lived together. That's her story. Have you proof that she's lying?
She's half his age.
Is that what bothers you? The age difference? His faint Glaswegian accent makes it sound like he's mocking me.
Her dress was covered in blood, I say.
Yes, I asked her about that. She claims to have comforted him until the paramedics arrived. They confirm her story.
She still could have beaten him?
Yes, which is why she's a suspect, the obvious one. But so far she's been cooperating fully, providing us with DNA samples and her fingerprints. She also claims to have an alibi, which we're checking out.
I feel tension knotted between my shoulder blades. There are old bruises on my father's body, on his ribs and lower back.
McDermott leans forward.
What bruises?
I take out my phone and find the photographs.
I took these at the hospital. They're at least a week old. See the knuckle marks?
McDermott studies the images. Any idea why someone would work him over?
No.
He picks up a pen and makes a note. I'll have someone photograph the bruises.
It could have been Olivia Blackmore.
We'll investigate that. In the meantime, when did you last see your father?
2 weeks ago. We had lunch at his club.
When did you last speak to him?
Thursday or Friday.
The truth is, I don't remember. I phone my mother every few days, but rarely my father, who isn't one for small talk or regular catch-ups.
Does your father have a mobile phone?
He doesn't see the point of them.
Phones?
He thinks people should make appointments and keep them without needing to constantly text to say they're running 5 minutes late or parking outside or walking through the door.
McDermott nods in agreement while glancing at the mobile phone near his left hand.
Did you know your father was in London? According to Mrs. Blackmore, he's here most weeks.
Not every week, I say defensively.
The detective holds my gaze for a moment, neither of us blinking. He casts his pen aside and leans back, scratching his stomach.
I went to my school reunion a few weeks ago, 25 years since I graduated. I didn't recognize half my old classmates. They were older, fatter, grayer, balder. Most of them bore no resemblance to the people they used to be. Then I realized that I was no different. Old and gray and growing fat. I caught up with guys who I was convinced were going to rule the world one day, who finished up delivering parcels for a living. Women who I thought were goddesses, who now had brittle hair, Botox smiles, and spare tires around their middles. Not all of them. Some had bloomed late. Girls that nobody looked at in school were strutting around that reunion like debutantes, new and improved by diet or exercise or surgery, or blessed with good genes. And didn't they know it?
Where is he going with this?
Then there were the nerdy guys, the ones who got bullied at school, the suits and the teacher's pets. Some of them finished up making a killing in the city, living in Surrey with wives who were 15 years younger and drop-dead gorgeous. People change, Professor. You can't predict who they'll become. You might think you can, but that's bullshit. Your old man got himself a hot young mistress and set up house. Even convinced her they were married. He's not the first and won't be the last.
She's lying.
Why would she do that?
She wants to blackmail us.
With what?
She could go to the papers and sell her story.
Is William O'Loughlin really that famous?
Once, perhaps, not anymore.
McDermott continues, can you think of anyone who might want to hurt him,
Anyone with a grudge?
He's a retired doctor. Surgeons make mistakes. One slip of the knife. He lives in Wales. He tends the roses and does the Times crossword. He doesn't have a mistress. Ask my mother. Ask anyone.
Where is your mother?
At the hospital. I'll need to speak to her.
Why? She doesn't know anything.
We'll have to confirm her whereabouts on Sunday night.
You can't seriously think she attacked him.
My sarcasm annoys the detective. He jabs a gnarled finger in my direction.
Where were you at midnight last night?
At home in bed, alone?
Yes.
He shows me a photograph.
Have you ever visited this house? It's in Barrowgate Road, Chiswick.
No. There's a knock on the door. A woman appears with a tray. Afternoon tea. Only one mug. McDermott uses his left hand to pick it up. He takes a sip.
We know your father caught the train from Wales yesterday afternoon. A black cab dropped him at the house at about 11:15. Is he the type of person to let a stranger into the house?
No.
Could he have met someone on the train and invited them home?
My father doesn't make friends easily.
McDermott makes another note. It could have been a botched robbery, although there were no signs of a forced entry and nothing appears to have been taken. There have been several home invasions in West London, but this doesn't quite fit the pattern.
What pattern?
A gang usually targets couples, tying up the wife and pistol-whipping the husband until one of them gives up the combination of the safe or tells them where the valuables are hidden.
He sips his tea.
We're working the usual areas, tracing your father's movements, his phone calls, investigating anyone who might have reason to attack him. We're also collecting CCTV footage from street cameras and neighboring houses.
What about forensics?
Soko pulled prints from the house and took samples. We'll run the results through the database, but any DNA won't be helpful unless we find a suspect.
He changes tack.
Let's assume, for argument's sake, that Olivia Blackmore is telling the truth.
She's not.
Who might know about your father's business affairs? His assets, life insurance policies, a will.
Kenneth Passage, my father's lawyer.
Would he be aware of William's double life?
I hesitate before answering. Kenneth is my father's oldest friend. If anyone knew about Olivia, it would be him. I scroll through the contacts on my phone and find his number. McDermott makes a further note and looks at his watch before standing and moving to the door.
Tell your mother that I'd like to speak to her.
She won't want to leave Dad. He's not going anywhere.
McDermott holds out his left hand for me to shake. I'm sorry about your father, Professor. I hope he pulls through.
Where is Olivia Blackmore now?
She's been released.
Can you stop her visiting the hospital?
How am I supposed to do that?
Warn her off.
McDermott's gnarled hand turns the doorknob. Unless you have some evidence that she's a threat, I have no grounds for telling her to stay away.
Please, I say. My mother doesn't know about her.
Well, you'd best go and tell her.
Chapter 6. Emma will be home from school by now. My housekeeper, Andy, will have met her at the East Gate and taken her for hot chocolate at a cafe on the walk home. Andy is Australian and speaks with an Antipodean inflection that turns every sentence into a question, a habit Emma has started to pick up. I call the flat. Emma answers,
"How's Grandad? Is he okay? Don't let him stay in hospital."
"He can't be moved. Not yet." Emma wants to argue, but that would mean mentioning Julianne and acknowledging what happened. I change the subject, asking her about school. She goes quiet.
"Is everything okay?" I ask.
"Yes."
I try to remember her best friend's name. "Is Zoe having a party for her birthday?"
"Yes."
"What's she doing?"
"I don't know. She didn't invite me."
"Did you have a fight?"
"Not really."
Emma doesn't sound too disappointed, but I feel for her. Julianne would know what to say.
She was good at this sort of thing, sorting out problems or finding silver linings.
Are you coming home?
Emma asks. Not yet, Squeak.
Can we get a takeaway?
Okay. Tell Andy I'll pay her back later.
Do your homework?
It's done. That's what you said last night.
Got to go.
I walk along Shepherd's Bush Road, heading for Hammersmith Tube Station. Dark clouds have been gathering all afternoon, massing on the western front. Their first salvos arrive, sleeting rain falling diagonally, smiting my cheeks and clinging to my hair. Commuters clog the pavements, hurrying with their heads down, collars turned up and umbrellas unfurled. I call Lucy from the station. She and Patricia have worked out a roster so that someone will be with Dad every hour of the day and night.
Mum wants to do tonight, says Lucy. Can you take over in the morning?
Sure.
Is 6 too early? 6 is fine. Did you talk to the police?
They think it could have been a botched robbery or a case of mistaken identity. Lucy doesn't ask about Olivia Blackmore, which means my mother is probably within earshot. I offer to call her later and tell her more. My train arrives, vibrating the rails and creating a pressure wave of rushing air. Doors open, bodies press forward. Shoulder to shoulder in the crowded carriage, I wonder how many of these people are leading double lives or have secret families. I'm not shocked by the idea. I've read about such things. The Zumba instructor who moonlights as a call girl, or the glamorous estate agent unmasked as a Russian spy. Secrets are valuable. We lie to protect a relationship, or get a job, or keep the peace, or win the girl, or protect a child. In a deep psychological sense, we have no self unless we have a secret. We grab for them whenever we begin losing ourselves in our social group, or work, or marriage. We reassert our identity as somebody apart. As a psychologist, I've counseled cross-dressers, transvestites, gender-conflicted teens, sex addicts, and closet alcoholics, all of whom hid their secrets, sometimes from themselves. One of my friends had a father who died of AIDS. It was only afterwards that his family discovered his regular visits to gay clubs and steam rooms. A colleague at my first NHS hospital was extradited back to Argentina and convicted of running a death squad during the Dirty War. These are life-changing secrets, not small white lies or sins of omission. Up until now, I've never had reason to question my father's integrity or doubt his love for my mother. He is a man of his word who has never asked me to uphold values or make sacrifices that he hasn't made himself. I don't want to believe that he's a liar, a coward, and a betrayer. But what if he is? Any man who keeps a separate family is sailing on a sea of lies, an ocean of untruths, piled one upon the other, until one day something triggers the tsunami and washes everything away.
It cannot be true. It must not be true.
The train is pulling into Barron's Court. Almost without thinking, I push my way off, apologizing to my fellow travelers. I'm on the platform. I find the stairs and the street, not knowing what comes next. Chapter 7. The cab drops me at one end of Barrogate Road, and I walk the length of the tree-lined avenue, which is flanked by handsome Victorian houses, each with the same gabled red tile.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.